blessed us to see today. You're always come full, God, thanking you for just being who you are and giving us another opportunity to be used by you. We thank you, God, for Pastor Johnson and this church opening up their doors and allowing us to come in this week and to be used by God. We pray, oh God, for all of us that are here, that as the word is going forth already, and Lord, our souls will be inspired to continue to press on. We always pray, oh God, that whatever we do, whatever we say, you will be glorified. That the church shall be edified. We thank you, God, for this opportunity. Hide us behind the cross so they may see you and they give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. We always pray that souls will be saved and lives shall be changed. In Jesus' name, amen. God for this opportunity to be in the house of the Lord, and we thank God for another day's journey. Yeah. I see my daughter up there singing, what a miracle. God still works miracles. Got sick on the other day, but we pleaded the blood of Jesus. And God still answers prayer. Come on, give God the praise. God still answers prayer. We thank God for this, because sometimes we get in situations, we got to realize it's a spiritual battle going on. Got to use the weaponry that God gave you in the name of the Lord. We give honor and glory to Pastor Johnson, this great church, to First Vice President Gibbs, Second Vice President Dr. Thibodeau, Third Vice President Dr. Gable, to our General Secretary, Dr. Bruce Bonds, our Treasurer, Reverend Jose Gardner, to our past President, Dr. Robert Turner, Sr. Let's give him a hand, everybody. Thank God for his presence, to all our other officers of cabinet, to our department officers, Ms. Bijou of the Women, Dr. Ray of Christian Education, Dr. Ray of the Layman, Ms. Youth, Ms. Naomi Green of our young people. We thank God for Barry Barrett Payton of our ushers, and to all our other auxiliary leaders. We thank God for our minister's wife, Ms. Ms. Davis, Wanda Davis. Thank God for her, and to all the auxiliaries, we thank God for you. And also to our wonderful pastors of this great church, our Pastors of our Association, all ask all the pastors to please stand. Amen. 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 To our recording secretary, Reverend Byron Johnson, one of the hardest working recording secretaries in the world. Amen. Thank God for him. He does a lot of things for us. And to all the other ministers that are here, the ministers of the gospel that are here, and all the other saints of God, it's good to be here. Amen? Amen. And to one of God's greatest churches. Amen? Amen. The Greater Liberty Baptist Church. Amen. Amen. Those members that are here, please stand. Those members of Greater Liberty Baptist Church, would you stand with us? We had a church anniversary today, and we thank God for that presence. Amen. You may be seated. And thank God for all the ministers of liberty that are here with us today. You already met my wife, all right? She got part of that story wrong. When I was in high school, I did start off playing basketball, but I got hurt. This lawsuit was the scorekeeper asked me to keep the scores for the B team. I started keeping the scores for the B team. Then I moved up to keep the scores for the varsity team. And in my last year, we went to the state championship. All right. Down in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. We won the state championship, but I got my picture in the paper. And it says, scorekeepers get excited too. The service has been great. The hospitality has been great. We thank God for that. And we dare not move on without thanking Dr. Georgia Hubbard and her great committee for the job well done. They will not be, and we thank God for her for the job well done and being doing logistics and all other things. We thank God for you and that committee, for God is good, and we give God the praise. There was a word found in Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 through 20. words are familiar to us. We've been dealing with these scriptures all week. Amen?
Amen.
Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 through 20. And it says, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass,
yes, sir,
one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law,
yes, sir,
to all be fulfilled. Whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments, and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven."
Right.
Turn to your neighbor and say,
"Neighbor,
I have a question for you.
Are you
ready
for this?
Are you
ready
for this?" This question is for every Christian. This question is for every believer. Are you ready for this? The word ready means to be prepared. It means to be available for service, available for action, and available for progress. I found out that preparation is the key to our success. Preparation is the secret door to significance. Great achievers, I've understood and I learned in and outside the church, understand the importance of relentless preparation of their mind, their body, their emotion, and their spirit. I understand that the quality of your preparation will influence the quality of your performance. Jesus was ready. He came ready. He came ready to do the will of God. His job was to get us ready. Because if we were going to be the people God wanted us to be, Jesus had to get us ready. Jesus in our text introduced his followers to being salt and light. In this world in which they live, he challenged them to start in their homes and to spread abroad. Yes, he inspired them to make an impact of speaking and demonstrating what they have learned. The word impact, as we learned this week, means to have a strong impact or effect on another person. It means to leave your impression on them through your ideas, your faith, your doctrine, and your works. The question on the floor is, are you ready for this? I understand that if you're going to make an impact for Jesus, if you're going to be the salt and the light God called you to be, guess what? You've got to be ready. You can't start getting ready. You've got to be ready. Because if God is going to use you, you're looking for some people that's ready to be used. Oh yeah, if you're going to be ready, the word in impact is spelled I-M-P-A-C-T. Guess what? If you're going to be ready, you need some information. Everybody say information. You've got to be informed by the informer. If you're going to make an impact and be ready to be used by God, you need some information. Jesus came teaching them the word of God. He put some information in them, some knowledge in them, that they may know what thus said the Lord. If you're going to be ready, you need some information. Then you also need some motivation. You must be motivated by the motivator. You see, God has given us the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Spirit is there to motivate us to do God's will. If I'm going to make an impact, and you're going to make an impact, you got to have information. But once you get that information, it ought to give you some motivation. But I think of the goodness of Jesus, and all he's done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah, that motivates me to keep on going. Once you have information and motivation, you need a proclamation. You see, once you got the information, once you have the motivation, you got to have the proclamation. And the proclamation is the good news. It's the good news about how Jesus came into this world, lived and died and was buried. But early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand. The proclamation is that if you're a sinner, God can save you from your sin. I don't know what you know about you, but I once was lost. But now I'm found and I'm blind, but now I see. I have to tell the world what he did for me. He can do it for you. dimension, guess what? You need to have an affiliation. You got to be affiliated with the feeling, the right affiliate. See, in other words, once you get ready to make an impact, you got to connect yourself with the right crowd. For the church is the right crowd. Jesus said, upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. You got to affiliate with the right crowd. You cannot be on the island by yourself. You got to learn how to connect with somebody else to help you to go along the way. Some of us want to do it all by ourselves. Guess what? Help yourself. I got to be affiliated with the right group. When I'm really with the right group, there's power in numbers. Oh, yes, you're going to make an impact. Guess what? You got to make sure you have information. You got to make sure you have motivation. You got to make sure you have a proclamation. You got to make sure you have the affiliation. Then guess what? The C is for you got to have the right confirmation. You got to be confirmed. Whenever you begin to do God's work and do God's will, the Bible says faith without works is dead. Because if you're going to make an impact, you got to have the Holy Ghost confirming that God is with you. The signs and wonders are to follow the things you said. There must be a confirmation in God, like God said to Jesus, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. And when you're doing the right thing and making the right impact, God will say to you, servant of God, well done. Not only must you have the information and the motivation and the proclamation and the affiliation and the confirmation, but you got to have a transformation. We're going to be salt in life. A change ought to take place in your life. Oh yeah, I once was blind, but guess what? Now I see. I've been changed. Things I used to do, I don't do no more. Places I used to go, I don't go to go. Why? Because I've been transformed by the power of God. You're going to be salt and light. You ought to see that your life has been changed. My brothers and sisters, in order to make a real impact on the lives of others around you, and I, guess what? You got to depend on your God. God is your God. God is our God. He is there to guide us and direct us in all our ways. Writer of Proverbs says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all our ways, acknowledge Him. I mean, to tell you, God said He'll direct your path. You better need God to direct your path. I don't know about you, but I need Him every day. I need Him every hour. I need Him every day. You can make a real impact. Guess what? You got to let God be your guide. You got to use your gifts. Don't you know God has given us gifts through the Holy Spirit? Somebody has the gift of knowledge. Somebody has the gift of wisdom and prophecy. Somebody has the gift of faith and healing and miracles and discerning of spirits and tongues and interpretation. I want to tell you, those gifts are for the church today. If you're going to make an impact, baby, you got to use the gift that God gave you. Stop looking at my gift and use what God gave you. What he wanted me to have, and God gave you what he wanted you to have. If you just use what you can have, God can bless you just like He's blessing everybody else. You're going to make a real impact. You got to follow your God. You got to make sure that you use your gift. You got to make sure that you manifest a godly lifestyle through the fruit of the Spirit. See, if you can't come trying to make an impact on my life when the fruit in your life ain't right. We need to see some love in you. So we must play a haters. And we need some love in us. We gotta have some joy in us. Guess what, baby? It's not about the things you have, it's the joy that God gives. You gotta have some peace. Like that brother said, his mean war. So much go around in our life, everything's about this. You ought to have some peace sometimes. If you're gonna manifest the power of God, you ought to have peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and also self-control. You're going to make an impact, baby. You ought to see the fruit in your life. Now, not the flesh, but the fruit in your life. And when you make an impact, God will change your life. My brothers, in this text, we see Jesus is making a kingdom impact. We see Him in three ways. And I'm going to leave you alone. We see Jesus in these verses in three ways. First of all, He made an impact as a prophet. He made an impact as a priest. He made an impact as a king. First of all, as a prophet, he said, as a prophet says in verse 17, think not that I have come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. But verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. In other words, Jesus came as a prophet. A prophet that one that declares he did not come to destroy the law. There are some people that come and their aim is to destroy what God has put in place. If they want to demolish it, they want to ruin it, they want to separate it, they want to pull it down. Guess what? If God is in control, I don't care how much you pull, it won't come down. How much you break, it will not break, because God is in control. And what's ever destruction means? All we do is tear stuff up. We just got a tan down spirit. Tear people down, tear places down, tear roofs down. We all like to destroy, but God said the prophet came not to destroy the law, but to fulfill the law. How do you destroy something your father put in place? See, I not only came not to destroy the law, but I came to give life. Others come sometimes to destroy, but Jesus said, I came to give life. And guess what? The word for fulfill in the Hebrew, there are two words, and one is mela, and that means to accomplish. The other one is kara, and it means to finish. Guess what? God is saying to the prophet, Jesus came to accomplish something and to finish something. God gave him a mission, and his mission was to accomplish what God gave him. He came to die for the sins of the world, to show us who God was on earth. He came with a purpose in mind to accomplish a goal. Did he accomplish it? But guess what? The Bible said he finished. On the cross, when he died on the cross, I heard him say, it is finished. It might be finished, but I'm not finished. So as a prophet, he came not to destroy, but he came to give life by fulfilling what God told him to do. Not only do we see him as a prophet making an impact, but guess what? We see him as a priest making an impact. Verse 19, it says, whosoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men, so he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus, as a priest, was a teacher. He was a teacher. He is a teacher. And a teacher is there, guess what? To teach us. To teach us systematically. To train us. To correct us. To counsel us. To command us. To order us. And to hand down traditions. As a priest, he identified the lawbreakers. He said, when I teach this law, guess what? If anyone breaks this law and teach others how to break it too, they'll be the least in the kingdom. Came as a priest to identify those who are breaking the law. Oh yeah, they're breaking the law. They're not obeying what God said, and they're teaching others to do the same. In other words, you a gambler. You teach other people how to gamble too. You a liar, and you don't know how to lie too. You a backbiter, and you know how to backbiter. It's all right. God knows you are. Yes, he does, but you're breaking the law. But some of us don't mind breaking the law until we get caught. Once we get caught, what, everybody have mercy on us then. Oh yeah, but see, the priest came to teach and to identify those who are breaking the law. Then the priest also came to inspire those to keep the law. He said those, when they are taught and they do wrong, the others do wrong, they're the lawbreakers. But then those who learn the word and obey the word and teach others to do it, they'll be great in the kingdom of heaven. Don't you know? God knows who the lawbreakers are, who the lawkeepers are. The priest's job is to teach the law, to let them know, let us know that this is God's way and God's will. Or do we see Jesus here in the text as a prophet? He is there fulfilling. We see him as a priest. He's there identifying the breakers of the law and the keepers of the law. But then finally, we see Jesus making an impact as a king. In verse 20 says, for I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no case enter the kingdom of heaven. Jesus, he examines one's righteousness. He looks at the scribes. Their job was to write the law, to write, copy the law, to record the law, and then to copy, make copies of the law. Their job was, they were subscribers. They were writing it down, but guess what? They were writing on parchment, but they weren't writing it in their hearts. Wow. And than the Pharisees, but that religious set of the Jews that had power and influence. Guess what? They were going through ceremony. They were going through the proper rituals, but guess what? They had no relationship with God. He said, except your righteousness exceed that of, but go beyond the scribes and Pharisees, you're going to be in trouble. And he said, sometimes it's about purpose because God's so folk going through the motion. They showed up Sunday after Sunday, just going through the motion. They know how to jump, you know how to shout, you know how to twist, you know how to do everything. It's just a formality. But after they leave that, they no good the same way they came. But guess what? We need relationship. Jesus said here, except you exceed. You got to do better than scribes and Pharisees. Because on the track they are going on, they're going to bust hell wide open. But you got to get higher than that. He said, not only must you exceed them, Jesus said, but guess what? Get this. He talks about, he says, you got to enter. If you don't exceed their righteousness, you can't enter into that. I know you saw it right. But if you don't change your behavior, you ain't coming up in here. You can't enter into the kingdom of God unless your righteousness is better than the scribes and Pharisees. And these were religious leaders. I found out the problem's not always out in the pulpit. The problem is up in the pulpit. In some places, if the pulpit gets right, the church will get right. If we start walking right and talking right, everything will fall in line. They say do what I say, and not as I do. You gotta do the right thing. He said, if you don't do the right thing, you're not coming up into the kingdom of heaven. Yeah. I want to tell you something as a close that Jesus was seen here as a prophet. Come on. A man that proclaimed the word of God. He said to them, I came not to destroy, but I came to fulfill. Yeah. That old devil, he comes to steal, kill and destroy. But I came that you might have life, having more abundantly. I came as a priest because my job is to put my all on the altar. I know you sin and come short of the glory of God. I know that you are not fit to die for the sins of the world. But I've been chosen from the beginning of the world as a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. I've been chosen to die on a hill called Calvary. As a priest, I'm going to make the ultimate sacrifice. I'm going to die for your sin. As a king, yes, I came to let you know that I am at the door. And you cannot come in unless your heart is right. But I got a question for you.
Trust me, leaders, our members, everybody needs power. is on fire with power. When the devil runs over, he gotta run out. When he runs over, he gotta run out. Because in every direction he goes in, there's nothing but power. When the power of God is in the house, lives will be changed. And souls will be saved. Because there's power, not in your name, but power in the name of God. Come on, give God a great praise.